Yep, these were the first chips I made on this lathe. I guess oil doesn't work as a primer. But at least I had the apron in bare metal within 10 minutes. Let's just step back a little bit. Yes, I decided to take the gears off from the apron. Not all of them, just the ones needed in order to get to the linkages. I don't know if you've seen my other videos, but when I got the lathe, the power feed and threading levers were not easy to engage. So I thought it would make sense to have a look inside, see how it works and maybe do some deburring. Also, it's a good chance to clean this housing really well. Oh, and check what's happening with the wobbling gears. So, the way the apron gearbox works on this lathe is pretty basic. The main lead screw is attached to the output shaft of the gearbox below the headstock. That's done with a soft pin, or a shear pin, that in theory will snap if we crash the lathe hard enough, avoiding damage to the gear train. As the spindle rotates, the change gears transmit power from the spindle through the gearbox to the lead screw. Now, besides the threads, the lead screw has a slot along its length where a key fits and drives a carriage pinion. That means the lead screw is able to transmit power to the carriage in two different ways. Using the ACME threads, when we engage the half nut, which should only be used for threading, and using the slot-driven pinion that indirectly drives the power feed gears. The purpose of the slot drive is to have a dedicated way to power feed while turning without using the threads. Since turning is the most common operation on a lathe, if we use the threads for that, we would be creating unnecessary wear on them. They should be only used for threading. And since this lathe has power feed on both Z and X axes, we have an extra lever that moves this hub to engage the corresponding axes. The selector hub also works as a gate, to avoid having the half nut engaged while power feeding or vice versa. Finally, we have a free gear that we can crank manually to position the carriage along the bed. Okay, so what about the wobbling gears? I had a look at them and found out the problem starts with the shaft concentricity. It's off by 1.5 thousandths and it's aggravated by the gear bore, which is not true to the gear face. I thought of making new gears, but I didn't want to delay the rebuild anymore. So instead, I reused the original parts, taking notes of all the dimensions. If this ever comes to be a problem, I can use the lathe to remake the shafts and gears and quickly replace them. One thing I noticed is that these gears are a bit smaller than expected, according to their modulus and teeth count. I even printed a PLA gear of the correct size just to check if it would fit, and it did. No problems there, but it also wobbles. These are metric, by the way, 1.25 modulus. But enough with the talking. The deburring is done, let's put this back together. Alright, now that I got these out of my system, we can move on and talk about the tool post. This lathe came with a 4-way tool post from the factory, and I wanted to replace it with a quick change type, so I got this one. This is an Aloris AXA wedge type replica made by China? Anyway, to mount these on the compound, I considered a few options. First was to machine and get rid of the boss for the original tool post location, and then use the steel plate that came with the tool post. That plate could be bolted on to the compound with some bolts at the corners. But this option had some drawbacks. The most concerning one was that the steel plate would add 10 mm or so to the tool post base height. And that means the tool holders would sit partially unsupported and below the tool post in order to be right on center. That was a no-go for me. Also, the threads for the stud were not square to the plate, and to be honest, in terms of rigidity, I'd rather not have that plate at all. Option 2 was to machine down the compound boss and make the tool post sit directly on the top of the compound. The original tool post stud is too short and flimsy, so a new hole needs to be drilled and tapped for the new stud. That's not a big deal, but if we look at the other side of the compound, we see the compound thickness is reduced right where we need to have some meat for the threads. So I have chosen a hybrid approach that involves modifying both the compound and tool posts. Using a coaxial indicator, I found the center of the tool post hole. Then I counterbored the bottom of the tool post, 20 mm in diameter, 5 mm deep. With this operation, I lost some of the threads, but that will not be a problem since these are only for keeping the tool post together. Then I reduced the diameter of the compound boss to 20 mm. And machine it down to 5 mm. Finally, I drilled and tapped an M12 hole. I didn't use the stud that came with the tool post since I don't have a 9/16 step for that, but also because I wanted to keep the new hole on the small side. In the end, I kept the boss to register the tool post and managed to get a good support for the new stud thread. I don't know yet if I'm going to get a solid block in the future to replace the compound arrangement, but so far this has been working well. Next, we have the gearbox. The main function of this gearbox is to transfer the power from the change gears to the lead screw, allowing to quickly select one of three feeding speeds. I didn't take this one apart because I wouldn't be improving anything. I just cleaned it well, deburred some edges, and repainted it. But I noticed the gears are hard to engage, particularly on this box, and that happens because the teeth are not actually designed to allow for an easy engagement. For instance, take this leg gear from a 1960s Mini. This end is for the first gear, which was not synchronized during the first years of production. What this means is that there is no mechanism in place when the first gear is being selected to help matching the speed of the main shaft with the speed of the wheels. The driver is responsible to make that happen, because if one of the gears goes too fast, the slow gear will see those teeth as a wall and will not engage. Being first gear, in this case it's easy to ensure the car is not moving. The same happens with this gearbox, and that's why we shouldn't be trying to change gears while it's running. But the design of the mini gears have something in their favor that makes them more effective, and that is how the sides of the teeth are cut. They are kind of chamfered back in two planes until the chamfers meet at the middle and create a pointy tip. Since the first gear is also cut like that, when we are engaging it and if two pointy tips meet, the gear being pushed will slide to one of the sides. Unfortunately, the gears on my lathe are poorly cut. Looks like there was an intention, but no delivery. For now, I don't think I can do anything to improve this. Before we wrap this up and I tell you to subscribe, click on that thing and do that other thing, let me just tell you about this steel plate. Hot rolled, 15 mm, ground on both sides. Very cheap and an excellent way to improve on the rigidity of a small lathe like this. Even with the crappy workbench where I have the lathe, the difference was night and day. Leveling also became much easier since the lathe is not sinking into the wood so easily. And before you ask, yes, I have plans to make a proper lathe stand. But first I have to finish some ongoing projects. For now, thank you for watching and see you on the next one.